Hi, I'm Ulf Riebesser. Ocean change is an ongoing process. The ocean has always been in a state of change, and life in the ocean has learned to adapt to it. But something is different in modern times. It is the mere speed of change. And there's something else special in the present global change, which makes it unique in Earth's history. Never before has a single species been able to bring about such drastic and sustained changes to our planet as those that are presently being initiated. That single species is us, Homo sapiens. That's why we call this era the Anthropocene, the age in which the impact of human activity on the environment is comparable to or even greater than natural influences. As scientists, we have an interest and a responsibility to unravel how global change will affect the ecosystems on our planet. As a marine scientist, I'm deeply concerned about the ocean ecosystems, which are not only important in terms of food provisioning for billions of people, but also play a key role in our planet's climate system. So let's take a closer look at this. What environmental changes do we expect in the ocean? And how will they affect marine life? Ocean change involves a range of environmental changes occurring simultaneously. Some are global, such as ocean acidification, ocean warming, the loss of oxygen. Others are more regional or local, such as eutrophication, pollution, increased sediment loading, and surface layer freshening. Take a look at this sketch, which summarizes some of the important environmental changes. As stated below the top arrow, the future ocean will be warmer, fresher, and more acidic. These primary changes give rise to a cascade of other changes, which all affect life in the ocean. For example, surface ocean warming shoals the depth of the upper mixed layer. This, in turn, decreases nutrient supply from deeper layers and increases average light intensity in the surface mixed layer. Both aspects, changing light and nutrients, have major consequences for the phytoplankton flourishing in the sunlit surface layer of the ocean. The uptake of large amounts of human-made CO2 by the ocean acidifies the seawater and causes a shoaling of the carbon solubility horizon, the level below which calcium carbonate dissolves. Climate change also affects the frequency and the intensity of extreme events, including major storms, which, among other things, affects the transport and deposition of dust over the ocean. It doesn't take much imagination to realize that it is virtually impossible to predict the combined effect of all these changes on marine life. In fact, a colleague of mine, Philip Boyd, has sketched the challenge posed to us when trying to unravel the biological impacts of ocean change as a Gordian knot. But scientists don't usually shy away from challenges. So they try their best to untie this Gordian knot, not with a sword though, but step by step by some clever science. Recent work has therefore switched to multifactorial experimental designs, testing for 2, 3 or more environmental factors. There's now mounting evidence that change in one environmental factor influences an organism's sensitivity to changes in other factors. These interactive effects of 2 or more drivers can be additive, they can be synergistic, which means amplifying each other's effect, or they can be antagonistic, dampening each other's effect. An example for how one environmental variable impacts an organism's sensitivity to another variable is shown in this schematic graph. Hypoxia, meaning a low oxygen level, narrows the thermal tolerance of an organism by reducing its metabolic scope. If another stressor is acting on top of the first, in this graph it's low pH, high CO2, the metabolic performance and thermal tolerance narrows even further. There's now increasing evidence of such additive or synergistic effects by multiple stressors in many groups of organisms. However, there's also some examples where one environmental change mitigates the effect of another. A nice example is that of the sea urchin. At 24 degrees Celsius, acidification from pH 8.7 to 7.6 reduces body size. At the optimum temperature of 27 degrees Celsius for this species, this negative pH effect is mitigated. Above the optimum temperature, pH sensitivity seems to turn up again, but somewhat less pronounced. Scientists are also on the way of tackling another challenge, that of species interactions. In nature, species react to ocean change not in isolation, but they're embedded in a community with complex interactions. These include competition, predation, parasitism, to name a few. So, for example, an adverse effect of ocean change on one species may be to the benefit of another, competing species. Understanding the effects of ocean change on community interactions requires that we expand our research from single species in the home laboratory to field experiments with natural communities. One way of doing this is by means of seagoing mesocosms, giant test tubes which can be deployed in the sea. This is kind of a model of this, a 1-to-5 model. So in reality, this is about 8 meters high, and each of these bags can take up to 55,000 liters of water. Results from these experiments show strong impacts of ocean change at various levels of the food web, which in part have impacts on the biogeochemical cycling and the air-sea gas exchange of climate-relevant gases. They all reveal an amazing complexity in the interactive responses. The third major challenge, which scientists need to tackle, arises from the fact that we are testing the sensitivities of today's organisms to tomorrow's environmental conditions. In reality, of course, the organisms have 50 to 100 years of time to adapt to future conditions. Is that enough time for organisms to adapt and keep ecosystems and their functioning intact? The adaptive potential of a species is proportional to its population size and its generation time. Highest adaptation rates are therefore expected for species with large population sizes and short generation times. So the question is not whether adaptation can occur, but whether it can occur rapidly enough to maintain ecosystem function and services unchanged. Addressing this question takes elaborate long-term studies, which are not easily combined with approaches used to tackle the other two challenges, such as the multi-stressor or species interactions. Bridging between the diverging fields in research on ocean change biology and integrating the knowledge gained in each of these will be a major challenge in the years to come. So, in summary, research on ocean change biology has made great progress over the past decade or two. And as shown in this graph, we have learned the most about single species responses to single environmental stressors exposed to short-term perturbations. So our present knowledge sits here in this graph in the lower front corner in this three-dimensional space. This is an important start. But the knowledge gained at this level cannot easily be extrapolated to higher levels of complexity. Science, therefore, is progressing along the red arrows on this graph, from single to multiple drivers using multifactorial experimental designs, from single species to communities and ecosystems conducting field experimentation with systems like this, moving up to community and ecosystem interactions, and from short to long-term exposure, testing for evolutionary adaptation. As our understanding expands towards the upper right corner of this graph, we will be better posed to predict scenarios of long-term ecosystem change under multiple stressors. It is this level of complexity that is needed to draw conclusions about possible changes in ecosystem services, develop management options, and provide policy advice. Even though scientists will not be able to make reliable predictions about the precise course nature will take in response to global change in the foreseeable future, I think we understand enough to know that it is time for us to change our course. Protecting the ocean ecosystems and the services they provide to us is in the interest of all of us.